to William Smith Free Methodist Church. My name is Michael Norman, and I have just a brief few announcements for you. They are actually all in here too, so if you didn't grab a bulletin, they're back at all the doors. First one, the Williamston Worship Fest is coming up. It is August 3rd, 7th. It's Saturday, August 3rd. It is going to begin at 1 p.m. It's going all the way through the day. There's a lot of acts that are going to be there. Even our own Amy Nichols is singing that day, so come on out for that. Second one, VBS is quickly upcoming. If you were here last week, you saw Pastor Lori. It is August 12th through the 15th. Still need lots of volunteers. There should be a little insert in your bulletin too. If you can come even just one of those days, it's in the evening, that would be really, really helpful. Last one, the Global Leadership Summit is held at Trinity Church in Lansing. It is August 8th and the 9th. I've been there the last 3, 4, 5 years. It's a really great summit. If you'd like to join us, just call the office. Finally, Todd. Todd, make sure that I won't forget him today, because this is not my everyday job. But if you are a visitor here with us this morning, we would love for you to leave with this gorgeous Williamson Free Methodist Church coffee mug. You can get one from said Todd or right up here through the main doors. Thank you.
If you all stand with us, we will continue worship this morning. I just want to say a personal thank you to those who helped fill in my family and I. We were gone for a couple weeks. And first of all, we really missed you guys. And so it's really good to be here again this morning worshiping with all of you. But thank you to all of you who stepped in and helped us out while we were gone to make it so we did not have to worry at all. So thank you so much.
Thank you. presence this morning with gratitude and thankfulness. God, that we can see in our past and our lives the ways that you've made a difference, that you've shown up to us, that you've given us your love. And God, we say thank you that we can wait in expectation and know that you're going to do it again. God, I just pray a prayer of blessing over everyone in this congregation this morning. God, I just pray that your Holy Spirit fills this place. We don't just say that, we mean it. God, I pray that we can all sense in a real way that you're here with us this morning. God, I pray as we move forward through the service that you speak to our hearts, that you change us, that you challenge us. God, may we leave here changed people. It's in your name we pray. Amen. You can be seated. And as you find your seats, the ushers can come forward at this time. Somewhere in your rows, this would be a good time, there's that black pew pad. You can sign that, sign in, update any information that may need updated, give us any prayer requests that you may have. That would be a good time to do that at this time. We are going to pray one more time over our offering, so would you bow your heads one more time and pray with me. God, we just continue to worship you. We just do it in a different way now. As we give you our tithes and offerings. God, I just pray that you bless the tithe, bless the giver. God, do work that only you can do. It's in your name we pray. Amen. So there was about 3,000 people that gathered in Florida and had meetings. They did some business. We elected new bishops. But also there was some time of training, encouragement. We met together with people who are on the same ministry journey. And it was really an encouraging time. So it was a great time we had in Florida. I just wanted to report that back to you. And Dave is on his way back. Should be in the office this next week. So as he's on his way back, he asked me if I would be willing to preach. So it's my pleasure to have the opportunity to bring the sermon this morning. We have been planning this for a few months, actually, now. And I knew that I was on the schedule to preach today, and I've been wrestling with what to share and what to bring to you guys. I felt like God was pulling me in a lot of different ways. I wasn't sure where I was going to end up. And then God just really laid on my heart to share kind of my story and my journey of faith. It's where I'm at now. It's where I've been for the past few months. And I feel like many of you out there can relate to where I am. So I just wanted to share how God's been speaking to me. So is that okay? Can I do that?
Yeah.
I'm glad you said yes, because I have four notes. Four pages of notes prepared for you to say yes. So if you would have said no, I'm not sure what we would have done. So thank you for saying yes. That's a good start to today. This morning's message is a little personal. It's a bit of my heart. I'm just excited to share it with you today. Before we do that, can we pray? I know I've already prayed twice, but can we pray a third time? Because I need it. So let's pray. God, I just pray that you speak through me, God, that these words that I'm about to share are not my words, but they're your words. God, I pray that the scriptures that I'm about to share resonate deeply with us. God, just help our focus to be on you over the next few minutes. Amen. So some of you may know bits and pieces of my journey and my history. But I grew up in a family where my dad was a third-generation pastor. So my great-grandpa, my grandpa, and my dad were all pastors. So as a kid, you always get the question, what do you want to be when you question, but I knew what I didn't want to be when I grew up, and I didn't want to be a pastor. And here I am. So God works in a funny way. He has a funny way of doing things, but here I am today. So when God first called me to ministry, and Melanie and I entered into full-time ministry, we were so excited. We still are excited, but we were really excited at the start. God was, you know, really, really firing us in some exciting ways. We were working in youth ministry. We were seeing lives changed. We were just excited to share the good news about Jesus. And we were seeing lives changed around us, and everything was going great. And we lived in this life kind of naive to the fact that there's this other side of ministry and this other side of life that isn't as exciting. But we were living in this life, we were fired up. God had called us to share news about his son to people. We were doing that. He still calls us to do that. We're still doing that. But at the time, we were just on cloud nine. But then life happened. And within our first 2 years of youth ministry, we walked alongside some teens whose friends committed suicide, teens who were deep in depression and were harming themselves, students whose parents lost jobs. We witnessed and walked through families in a season of divorce. In 2 years, we had three families in our youth groups lose the fathers of their family unexpectedly. We had numerous friends at the same time who lost babies due to miscarriage, and they struggled through that cycle of hope of a new baby and then the letdown and the pain that was caused by the miscarriage. So what started out in ministry as this exciting, top-of-the-world feeling soon led to nights where Melanie and I would just lay awake and talk to God, literally weeping to God, saying, "Where are you? What is going on? We need you, God." For me, the moment changed when there was a family in our youth group, and they had two boys who we were really close with. And their dad was diagnosed with brain cancer. It was just a short matter of time he passed away. And I was charged with ministering to these young men and trying to give them answers that I just didn't have. I don't know the answers. I didn't know what to say in those moments. I watched as these two boys grew up and they graduated, and the whole time I knew that shouldn't be me watching them, it should be their dad. And I struggled with that process. And so over these past couple years, as we've continued on, it feels like to me that there's just been hurt after hurt after hurt. And there's times where I struggle. And I'm being honest, I struggle to know where God is. And at the same time, you know, Melanie and I are working in ministry and we're living in ministry. We're preaching about the goodness of God. We're singing about how great our God is. At the same time, we're living in this tension where we do know God is great. We worship God. God is amazing. But at the same time, life is hard. And there's so many hurts and there's so much pain in this life. There's this tension between the reality of the eternal hope of heaven and the pain and hurt of our time on earth. And so this tension is something that I've been struggling with. It's something that we've been navigating. And quite honestly, it's exhausting. So that's where I'm coming at this morning. I'm sorry to be depressing or sad, but that's just kind of where I'm at. It's real life stuff. I think many of you have experienced this same type of feeling. I know even in the time that we've been here, just these two short years, there's been so much pain and hurt and loss. Just within this church, so I know many of you know what I'm talking about, and we feel the deep weight of this all. And so, as I've been struggling with how to deal with this and how to cope with this, and in ministry, how to give the right answers, there are those cliche Christian responses, but none of those seem to settle with me and to resonate with me. I still just struggle with not having the right answers, not I've struggled with the question, what can I do? And many times I stay up at night and I just talk to God and say, God, I can't. I can't do this. I just can't. And so God has been working through me and speaking to me. And so it's with that frame of reference that I want to bring the message this morning. With that being said, let's start. The conclusion of these thoughts and these prayers and these wrestlings that I've had with God, the conclusion of all these emotions that I've been feeling, and what I want to share with you today is that I can't, and that's okay, because I have a God who can. And so that's kind of the process and the lesson that I've learned. And so we're going to take a look, we're going to open up some scripture here and just look at some other examples of people who were facing life situations where they felt like, I can't do it, but I have a God who can. And so we're going to start off in the book of Habakkuk. And so I don't know where many of you gather inspiration from God. For me, it happens in the shower. So as a parent of two little kids, you get 10 minutes of free time every day, and that 10 minutes of free time happens in the shower. So you go in, you lock the door, and you just pray that nobody knocks. And so it was in this moment that I was taking a shower, actually at my parents' house. So I was on a different floor. Our house is a ranch. My parents' house is two floors. So I was on a whole different floor than my kids. So it might have been a 15-minute shower that day. I'm not sure. When I take showers, I turn on Christian music and I blare it as loud as I can. So I was blaring this Christian music, which, by the way, I just started doing that recently, and it's actually really been super beneficial in my life. And really, God has used that time to really challenge me and change me. So if you just maybe you don't listen to Christian music that much, maybe you do, but I challenge you to just turn on some Christian music. You'll be surprised at how much God speaks through that. But I was in the shower, I was listening to Christian music, full blast, using that 15 minutes to just kind of turn my mind off, and then my mind started racing, and I was like, God, this is not what I wanted to use this time for, but here we go. And so God was speaking through this song, which at the end of service today, Melanie and the team are going to come up and sing this song that I feel like God was really, really putting on my heart to share. But as that song was playing, as the lyrics of those words were playing, Habakkuk chapter 3 came to mind, and I have no idea why, because I could probably count on one hand the amount of times I've read this chapter. It's just a minor prophet at the end of the Old Testament, but God put this specific set of verses in my mind, and I couldn't get them out of my mind, so I knew I was preaching today. I literally ran downstairs, and I told Melanie, I said, back to chapter 3, write it down before I forget. She did it. And so these are the verses. But before I get to those, I just want to share the setting of what's happening when Habakkuk shares these words. So Habakkuk was a minor prophet, like I said. Unlike many of the other prophets, he doesn't predict the future necessarily, but he is speaking throughout his book in the three chapters there in this writing style called lament. Not super exciting, but it's just him sharing his feelings and going back and forth with God. And through his book, he's addressing God personally, personally addressing God with his struggle. And he's trying to believe that God is good, but he's in the midst of some incredible suffering. So Habakkuk lived in the final decades of Israel's southern kingdom. And what was going on in Israel's southern kingdom at the time was that people were living terribly simple lives. There was injustice, there was violence, there was idolatry, there was unfaithfulness. People were turning from God left and right. And at the same time, there was a political pressure being put on because there was this power called Babylon that was fast approaching. And Habakkuk knew that if they came anywhere close to the southern kingdom of Israel, they stood no chance. Babylon would wipe them out. And so Habakkuk is living in this time as a faithful man of God. He's living where nobody else understands him. where he's watching everyone turn away from him, where he's watching them turn to sinful desires, and at the same time, he's knowing that it's only a matter of time before their region gets attacked by Babylon. And so he is in this season where he's in incredible suffering. And so if you read the first 2.5 chapters of Habakkuk, he just goes back and forth with God, lamenting about his situation and begging God to do something. And it's really kind of a sad book, but read it sometime. But as he's doing this, he gets to verse 17 in chapter 3. And here he's speaking in metaphor, but he says this: "Though the fig tree does not bud, and there are no grapes on the vines, though the olive crop fails and the fields produce no food, though there are no sheep in the pen and no cattle in the stalls, yet I will rejoice in the Lord. I will be joyful in God my Savior." He's saying, despite everything being just absolutely terrible, I'm going to choose to worship and rejoice because I know God is good. And so I think this can relate to our lives when we're battling in the struggle, when life is overwhelming. We have a choice. We have a choice to turn away from God, or we have a choice to praise God. So Hudson is our son. He's almost 3 years old, and he has a favorite phrase that he likes to say, and that phrase is, "I don't want to." And those of you who are parents can probably remember that phase of your children's life. And oftentimes Hudson adds on a word to this phrase, and he says, "I don't want to," later. And so he can't say his R's, so it sounds like later. But if you say, "Hudson, brush your teeth," he says, "I don't want to," later. If you say, "Hudson, get dressed," "I don't want to," later. "Hudson, come to the dinner table," he says, "I don't want to," later. And so he's constantly saying, "I don't want to, I don't want to, I don't want to," later. And I think a lot of us have that same attitude when it comes to praise, especially when we're living in some hard times and we're navigating some rough waters, where we know we're supposed to praise God, we know God is good, but in the moment, in that moment of pain, in the moment of suffering, we just say, "I don't want to." Maybe later when moments are good, when we're back out of the valley, maybe then I'll praise, but right now I don't want to. Maybe later. But that's not the direction that's given in Scripture. David in Psalm 34:1 says this: "I will extol the Lord at all times. His praise will always be on my lips." And so this idea that always having praise on our lips, this unconditional praise that exists and that just comes out of us no matter what our situation is. And so really what I'm left with, knowing my story and my situation where I've been the last few months, is that this all makes sense to me, that we're supposed to praise, but how can I do it? How do I do it when life is so difficult? And so that's where, again, I've come to that conclusion that on my own, I can't do it. I can't do it, but God can, and God can change me. And so all of this inspiration from my 15 minutes in the shower came at me, and I started thinking and developing this sermon, and then we went to General Conference this past week. And Bishop Thomas shared a message on the last night of General Conference that really resonated with me. And he shared the story of two people. And I think the stories of these two people connect well with what I'm talking about today. And so he shared the story of Daniel and the story of Joseph. And so you probably know these stories pretty well, but just a quick recap. We're going to look at these stories kind of side by side, a recap of their stories. So first, Joseph, we remember that his brothers got jealous of him. They sold him into slavery. He eventually, through a series of events, wound up in Egypt. And then through a series of another series of events, he winds up in front of Pharaoh. And Pharaoh chooses him to interpret his dreams. And so that's in Genesis 41, verse 15 and 16. Pharaoh said to Joseph, "I had a dream, and no one can interpret it. But I've heard it said of you that when you hear a dream, you can interpret it." "I cannot do it," Joseph replied to Pharaoh, "but God will give Pharaoh the answer he desires." So we're going to leave that story and go to Daniel. Again, we're doing this quickly. Daniel, so there's this King Nebuchadnezzar. Nebuchadnezzar was a really bad guy. That's putting it lightly. But Nebuchadnezzar demands that someone in the land not only interpret his dream, but first tell him what his dream was and then interpret it. And he says, "If nobody can tell me what my dream was and then interpret it, then I'm going to kill all the magicians and the diviners and the interpreters in the land. I'm going to kill them all because nobody can do it." And so he chooses Daniel to come forward, and Daniel, he chooses to challenge him with telling him his dream and interpreting it. And so in Daniel chapter 2, verse 26, it says, "The king asked Daniel, 'Are you able to tell me what I saw in my dream and interpret it?' Daniel replied, 'No wise man, enchanter, magician, or diviner can explain to the king the mystery he has asked about. But there is a God in heaven who reveals mysteries.'" So I'm going to take a look at both Daniel and Joseph's responses here side by side. So if you hit the next slide, I'll put them up side by side. Daniel and Joseph, we know them as pillars of faith, as strong men of God. We know them as heroes, but they both have the same answer. Despite their wisdom and despite the strength that God has provided them and the gifts that God has given them, they both have similar responses. If we look at Joseph's first, he says, "I can't do it. I can't. I can't do what you're asking me. But I have a God who can." And if you look at Daniel's response, he says the same thing. "There's nobody who can do it, including me. I can't do it. I can't do the challenge you're asking me, but I have a God who can." They both say, "I can't, but God can." We live in a world today that tells us that we can be anything that we want to be, and we can become anything we want to be. We can do anything we want to do. Which sounds fine, which sounds good, but the reality is that that's simply not true. The fact of the matter is it doesn't even matter how capable you are or how capable you think you are. It's to handle the hurdles of life, you simply can't do it by yourself. Daniel and Joseph, again, two powerful men of God. They're blessed with wisdom, blessed with strength, but they knew this. They knew they couldn't do it alone. They knew they needed God. They said, "I can't, but God can." They said, "I can't do this, but guess what? I have hope because I have a God who can." And so through this realization that I've been making in several different areas where I'm realizing in my life that I can't do it, but God can, through this realization, something that I'm realizing in the struggle is that I won't have the answers. And I feel like that's the struggle of dealing with pain, is not having the answers and not knowing why things are happening. I won't have all the answers. I won't have the ability to fully understand. I'll never have the ability to respond as I'm dealing in ministry, respond to people with all the right answers. I don't have that ability. I can't do it myself, but I have a God who can. I have a God who I can choose to turn everything over to. I have a God who's in control, and I have a God who's working all things out. So the struggle of praising God, even though it doesn't come naturally, it's still a struggle. But to praise God when life is chaotic, it's a struggle. It's hard. But why do we do it? Why is it important that we should praise at all times? Because in the midst of sorrow, in the midst of our valleys, and the heartaches, and the confusion, and the loss, and the loneliness, and the busyness, and the mundane, in the death, and the questions, and the waiting, in the valley, He deserves our praise. Because we can't do this And so that's where I'm at in my journey. That's kind of my admission of where God has been leading me and directing me. It's that I don't have all the answers. I don't know by myself how to process things. I don't know how to understand this life and this time on earth. However short it may be, I don't know. I don't know how to do it by myself. But the one thing I do know is that even though I can't, I have a God who can. And I count on that one thing. And because of that, I have a reason to worship and I have a reason to praise. So today as we close service, and it's your lucky day, we're going to get out a few minutes early. As we close service, I've asked the worship team to come forward, and they're going to share the song that inspired me while I was taking my shower. But the title of the song is Yes, I Will. And I want to close today by reflecting, by praying, and most of all by declaring that we, as a church, we as people are not going to let the trials of life overcome us or stop us or hinder us from praising God, but rather that we are going to choose to praise Him unceasingly. And so this is a new song. You may or may not know it. I invite you to sing along, to pray. The altar's open. I don't know what kind of season you're going through. I don't know what you're dealing with in your life. I don't know what pains and hurts are facing you today or tomorrow or in the past. I don't know what you're bringing to the table and bringing to God today. But I know that we have a God who's worthy of our praise. And I know that we have a God that, even though when it feels like we can't, we have a God who can. And so, the lyrics I was going to share on the screen, so that's good. We have a God who never fails. He's not going to fail us now. So let's worship Him. And let's praise Him. And so the team is going to start. We'll sing Yes, I Will. Again, the altar's open. You can stay in your seat. You can stand. You can sit. You can sing. I don't care what you do. But just listen to these words. Reflect on them. Think on them. Pray them over your life. So team, you can lead us, and then I'll come back up and pray to close.
Yeah.
because you are worthy. You are worthy of our praise. Despite of our situations, despite of our scenarios, despite of our life's thoughts and hurts and pains, God, you are our God who is worthy of our praise. And so, God, today, in this moment, God, today, moving forward, we declare that we will choose to praise you. And so, God, that is our promise. That from this point forward, we will live lives of praise. And as David said in Psalm, it doesn't matter the situation, we will always have praise on our lips. God, may that be true in our lives. May that be true in my life.